Okay, well, what's the idea? Why are we all gathered here? Okay, so Mitch and I, we've been doing this. I started in June 2020, so I've been at it for just over 3 years. I suppose it took about 5 months to actually work through Stuart's modules and get to the point where I had everything ready to launch. And I started advertising on YouTube. Really, I think I was encouraged to go down that route. And I quite enjoy making videos. So I suppose it seemed a sort of natural first step to take. And I started off spending, I think I was spending 1 euro 50 per day on two campaigns. I think that's how I started. So I've always run campaigns or adverts or videos or messages against each other. So that this idea of split testing, so that we can find a winner and then, try and improve on that. And gradually over time, you optimize and evolve and, you sort of finesse your communication to the point where it's about as effective as it's going to become. And yeah, I've been earning my income this way ever since. So it's marvelous. And I think Mitch will tell us his story in a moment, but I think because we're both in our 60s now, and we've both made this transition, and I just I feel like, although we do we're not obliged to do this as affiliates. We don't have to even be in touch with you guys. There's no obligation at all. You've come into the program, and Launch You are looking after you now. Okay, but I think we do this because we get a kick out of helping you guys, seeing you guys win, guiding you, steering you in the right direction. And there's a phrase that I picked up a long time ago: we rise by lifting others. All right, and I really like that one. People have I'm getting emotional now. People have helped me in the past, and when my dad was at the end of his life, he was handing it down. He was passing on all his knowledge to me in the woodworking workshop. And I just feel it's almost a duty when you get to a certain time of life that you make some sort of contribution and give something back. So that's my little speech. We're here to see your questions. There's no presentation. Come out with your questions. Don't be shy. If we can steer right, then that's what this is all about. So what would you like to say, Mitch, by way of introduction?
I recognize most of the people here today, which is nice. I started the same thing and the same way as John, doing affiliate marketing. The difference is I then went off and built the website for our guest house. And then after that, I went and built a site training people how to market their guest houses. So I've got three different sites going at the moment. And hopefully I'll build a fourth one in the winter. For those of you in the Southern Hemisphere, it's about to become winter in the next month or two, I guess. And the reason why I could do more in the winter is because we shut the guest house, which is fantastic. It'll be the first time in 7 years that we could afford to shut the guest house in the winter. Before, we were just desperately clinging on to any income. So it's nice, makes a nice change. And I'll try and build a fourth site. So that's my plan over the next 3 years, to get two or three going and earning money, and then take it from there by doing as little work as possible. Anyway, what I'm going to do is, anyone can ask a question. You can ask a question in two ways: put up your hand, or like Carol, very prepared, Sutcliffe has done. She's dropped them into the chat box. I can't see Carol. Are you hidden away, Carol? There you come. There you go.
There I am.
Right. Could either of you, oh, that's probably you then, John. Could either of you answer the following questions for me?
I can't actually see anything in chat, so I haven't got the question hasn't come into my chat, so I think you have to read it out, Mitch, please, if you don't mind.
Okay. Well, the first one I can answer from my point of view: is a sole proprietorship or a partnership the best way to start with me and my sister from a tax point of view? I've got no idea. So what you need to do is chat to an accountant. Which country are you in, Carol?
In South Africa, Mitch, I'm just wondering what you guys, do you have a sole proprietorship for your guest house business, or is it a PTY limited, or is it a partnership, or what did you choose and why?
So the guest house is a private limited company.
PTY, and, okay.
Yeah, and Modern Wealthy is just a limited company based in
a
the
limited
UK.
Company.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So,
because they're very, very easy to set up in the UK.
Okay. So I don't know if John has any input on the different, what he would recommend, but it doesn't matter. I can ask people that are experts in that area. And the second question I had was, you say you've got 2-3 websites. The one is LaunchU.
Yeah.
But have you connected or linked your other two websites in any way? So there's
the bed and breakfast one, not at all. It's called evermont.com. And that just markets the bed and breakfast.
Okay.
And it doesn't do any cross-selling because it doesn't make any sense. Because you're trying to get people to come and stay here for 2, 3, 4, 5 days. So I've just taken all the learning from what I've learned on Launchpad and built that site up. So you can go and have a look at that.
I have.
It's doing very well now. But that's not linked to anything.
So what would you attribute your success or leaderboard number one position? What do you attribute that to? It's got nothing to do with what other things you're doing.
I think it's mostly based on looks.
Well, then, I'm definitely in the running.
Why did you first start laughing?
I said, then I must be in the running too.
That wasn't a joke. I'd started Modern Wealthy. I said to Vicky, I would run it till I'd got 10 members. Then I would use the learning to fix up the website for our guest house. And I did that, but I stopped when I only had 3 members in Modern Wealthy. I just left it for a while. And it took me 3 months, nearly 4 months to do the guest house site. Because if you go and look at it, you'll see there's lots and lots of videos that I had to film of all the people and edit them and get that all done. Then I decided it would be a good idea because some guest house owners saw that site and they wanted one for their guest house. So I built 2 other guest house sites, but I don't do that now because it's a lot of work. And it's like naming someone's baby. You know, someone comes to you and says, my husband and I can't agree. I want you to name our baby. You're never going to win that battle. And it's the same with people's guest houses. Everybody just was unhappy with the photos and not happy with this. And I ended up doing quite a lot of work to build a site. I don't do that anymore. Somebody asked me to build a site. I send their name to a guy in Zambia called Andy. And he builds websites very well and very quickly.
Okay, excellent.
And then I went back to Modern Wealthy and concentrated on getting videos right, talking to people like you.
Okay. All right, then just the last question. Those people, all of those other guest houses and restaurants and businesses that you have partnerships or links with, you don't promote any of them in an affiliate fashion for commission?
No, not on the guest house side. I've started now and you'll start getting emails. That's probably, you've probably passed the point. I've become an affiliate for Convertly and affiliate for AWeber. So I've joined an affiliate scheme for all of these, which I will start passing on. And there you can earn not very much. You earn a few bob a month, but I thought I might as well maximize everything. But you can go to some sites, and I forget the name now, but if you just type into Google affiliate sites, there's 2 or 3 big ones, and you can become an affiliate for nearly anything. And they list all the sites, and you can rank them by size of commission, all of that stuff.
Yeah. I've actually got a number of partnerships, or we have a number of partnerships with lifestyle centers and schools and colleges that we want to promote through an affiliate partnership. So we're going to go visit some people in Joburg this coming week. So, John, we're getting there. We're almost ready for our interview.
Yes, good.
Once we have our partnership signed. Thank you for that, Mitch. Thank you for your input there. So just to tell you, we're making progress, imperfect action all the time, starting before we're ready. And we'll let you know the moment we have some people signed up. And our website is going to look beautiful. It will be ready in a couple of weeks. So I'll share that with you once that's done. See what you have. What do you think of it?
Fantastic. Yeah, I'm a sole trader. And so I'm not a limited company or anything like that. And Ursula Spendley has put a note in the chat as well, which you might like to sort of have a look at. But what I would suggest is that because tax laws are different in every, rules and regulations are different in every country around the world, you must seek advice from a local tax specialist.
A tax accountant.
And they will advise you. You can sort of tell them about your startup costs and, what you're shooting for, and if this is something that you're involved with your sister, then whatever your personal circumstances are, and he's best positioned to give you the right advice, Carol.
Okay, awesome. No, definitely. And that's one of the things we're going to do on our trip up north this coming week, is to see a friend who is a tax consultant and go into the details of what would be best there. So is that the information somebody sent? Ursula sent me information. Thank you, Ursula. I'm just going to copy that. Thank you. Yeah, that's me.
Very good. Okay. All right. Well, we look forward to seeing your, the results of your labours in the not too distant future.
Thank you.
Yeah. How
Thank
exciting.
You. Yeah. Right. God bless you all. Thank you. Bye.
So Miriam has lost her voice, John. So I'm going to be Miriam.
Okay.
Can you explain, if you explained before, how you connect with someone in your area to form an accountability partner? So you're in Toronto, and I don't know the names of folks in Toronto, but if you go onto you can go either to the Facebook page or you can go to the mentors page. Have you seen the place there where you can leave messages? Because there you can try and find somebody else who's in Toronto and just ask them. What I've found is that people are super keen to join up with somebody else. I've never had a problem. I think I've worked with 7 or 8 different people during my time here. And if you count John, but John was different. He kept stalking me, so I had no choice. But there were 7 or 8 different people that I reached out to and said, let's do something together. And you work together. A couple of them, it didn't work out. After 3 or 4 months, we just stopped. But no harm done. Just look for people in your area. And ask them, send them an email if you can't talk. And then ask them, you want to be an accountability partner. And then also ask people what stage they're at. Because you want to be at a similar stage to somebody else, because you'll be going through the same issues. It's such a good thing to do. And I recommend that for anybody, especially if you're somebody like Junie, who's decided she's going to conquer the world by Wednesday, is to find somebody who's on the same path as you, and just share information with them. And it's just nice to have a call once a week, and you can say stuff you're struggling with, and they say stuff they're struggling with, and you help each other. That's how I mainly use it. I've also used it before with a guy called Dan, just to make sure I did the work. So we used to agree what we were going to do by the next week, and then you get on and do it. Otherwise, you have to have the phone call. And the other guy's done it, and you haven't done it. And so, but it sort of motivated me to get things done as well.
Yeah, can I add something to that?
You should.
Right. So if I don't know whether you've opened up chat. If you're on a computer and you go down to the 3 dots more at the bottom, and you click on those, you'll see that chat appears. Right. And if you open up chat, there's a blue button down the bottom that says everyone on it, and it's got a little down arrow. Okay, and if you click on that blue button, you'll see all the names of the attendees in this meeting. All right, and if you click on one of those names, click on any one of those names, click on Mitch Weber or Nevin or, you know, Virginia or anybody, and you can send them a private direct message. Okay, you can't do this on all Zoom calls. It depends how the Zoom call's set up. But a lot of the Zoom calls where you've got the participants on the screen, you know, some of the Zoom calls that Justin makes, they're a presentation and you can't see who the attendees are on the call. But this type of call, you can send out messages to individuals, which I've done before. And I had a friend request from one, I'm not going to name any names because I just think it's the right thing to do. But I had a friend request from somebody that's recently started to become a regular on the leaderboards, on the affiliate leaderboards. Okay. And that friend request then turned into a message, and this person said, can we connect? Can we have a call? And brilliant. Yeah, of course you can. Of course you can have a call with me. You know, it costs nothing. So there are no rules. You can reach out to Stuart Ross if you want. Now, you won't get a reply from him. I pretty much guarantee that. But there's no reason why you can't, you know, reach out to anybody. And I wouldn't necessarily limit it to people in Toronto. I mean, maybe people in a similar time zone makes sense. Okay. But, you know, because we're, you know, you're going to have these Zoom calls on the computer. So it doesn't really matter where these people are, as long as it's going to be convenient to connect up when the time comes. And the other thing I would suggest is, in order that you don't kind of commit yourself too soon, is you say to this other person, let's run a trial for, let's say, you know, a month, and we'll meet once a week, and then we'll decide if this is something that we. Okay, so you're not going to get yourself involved in a situation that you can't. You're going to feel bad about pulling out of. Okay, so just be completely upfront and. Yeah, I hope that helps.
So James has put his hand up. James, you will see on your screen as user. So Virginia, maybe you want to have a chat with James. I think it was Virginia who was asking. I forget now. But James is looking for an accountability partner. He's got his light on his computer very bright, so you can't see him properly. Okay.
Yeah, you're a bit blown out. That's better.
Did we chat the other day? You were in your office, James.
Yeah, James, you're muted.
Yes, come on.
That's it. You got it.
All right. No, Mitch.
Okay. I was chatting to a guy who had sunglasses like that, and it was funny because he was standing in the IT room in his office because he said to me he wants to have a chat. So I said, well, how about now? He went, okay. And then when I called him up, he was at work, but he got into the computer cupboard at his office. And he was standing in there. I said, here's another idea. Just let's have a call at 6 and you can sit on a chair. It was funny. So, Jenny Junker, anybody in London? Yeah, but Jenny, think of what Mike said. If there could be anyone in the world who's on the London timeline. So that didn't make sense. But, you know, South Africa, you can chat to South Africans, French, Belgium, anybody who's going to have calls with you at a reasonable time. And that's lots of people, because the only ones that are difficult for me, I think, are New Zealand. Whenever I chat to someone in New Zealand, they want to have it at like 4 or 5 in the morning or 10 at night when I've got to go to bed.
Yeah, there's another question popped into chat from Stephen.
It says John on it. Stephen, off you go.
Hi, Mitch and John. Kindly advise on this low-cost Google marketing, which platform in particular, any budget estimates per day, week, month? Also, which particular training should I attend to master it? Okay. So, I did. I mean, I advertise on, I did a number of these, I did three of them, I think, for the In Focus calls once upon a time, and I believe the trainings are still in the archive somewhere. If you want to locate those low cost YouTube advertising trainings, then I suggest you click on the chat bubble and you put the question to support. All right, you ask them where you can find the trainings. They should be able to guide you. I'm afraid I don't know where they are. But it doesn't really matter which one of the social media platforms or search engines we're talking about. They all start from $1 per day. But we can set a campaign up with a daily budget. We can set a campaign up with many different types of budget. With a campaign budget, for a budget, with a budget for the entire campaign. But what we do is set the campaign up with a daily budget, and the daily budget can be as low as $1 per day. Now, depending upon where you are in the world, you're going to be setting up your Google Ads dashboard in your local currency. So it may be set up in the euro or the rand or the GB pound or whatever. So it's going to be, I think, something around about a dollar equivalent will be the lowest amount of money that you can spend per day, right? And what I was proposing was an idea that I was taught when I came in 3 years ago, and that was to set up global campaigns with a number of geographical exclusions, right? And I talk about these in the training. So we don't target India, for example, and some of the countries surrounding India, because there are lots of English speakers there, but financially challenged. And you'll find you'll get lots of leads coming into your dashboard and into your AWeber, but you won't get anybody with the money to buy anything. Okay. So I think we've got to kind of take a step back. And if you've determined who your niche and your avatar is, where is this person going to be hanging out? First of all, I mean, they may be on, it may be more likely that they're on Facebook, right? And it may be that you don't want to run video ads. It may be that you want to run text ads because you don't want to be a face on the internet. You don't want to put yourself out there just yet. It's too soon, maybe, to be making videos and, putting yourself on YouTube. Like, that's not everybody wants to do that. So we've got Google pay-per-click. We've got what you need to think about, I think, before actually setting the campaign up and running the ad is, are these, how do I want to spend my days? What do I want my lifestyle to look like? And that includes my work. Do I want to be an influencer? Do I want to run video ads? Or do I want to be in the background? Do I want to lurk in the shadows and not talk to anybody, communicate with anybody? Okay. And then once you fit, I mean, Stuart takes you through these exercises in module two. You've got this self-discovery process, if you like, where you're going to figure out what you like doing and what you don't like doing. He didn't like cold selling. I mean, who does, door knocking, cold selling and so forth, which is why he was very happy to move into this idea that, we can attract people that we'd never have to deal with, right? That's what we can do with attraction marketing or authority marketing. So once you've figured out, what you want your work description to look like in this internet marketing endeavor that you're taking on, then the next step is to figure out, your niche and avatar, and where are they going to be, where are they going to be on the internet? Are they going to be searching for something in Google search? And if they are, it's very easy, it's very straightforward for you to put your message in front of those people on page one of Google search. And the adverts that you run there don't actually even cost any money at all until somebody clicks on them. That's why they're called pay-per-click. So you can be on page one of Google for free, okay? And when people do click, it will just be a cent or two or three. It'll never be a lot of money. Not if you're running these low-cost campaigns, because we're advertising globally. We're gathering lots of data we're able to test different messages, different headlines, different body copy, different scripts, different ideas, different targeting. This is the whole purpose of the low cost strategy. We do lots and lots of testing. First of all, we figure out that the funnel works without spending a load of money, without wasting, burning money. And then we go on to set up lots of tests. Usually going to be running two ideas against each other. It will be the same ad with different targeting in two campaigns to figure out what targeting is hitting the mark. Or it will be two different messages to the same targeting, so we can figure out which message is going to be resonating. So, and this is the way that we evolve as marketers and improve and optimize, become more profitable. So, yeah, reach out to support to see if the if those trainings are archived somewhere, and they'll give you. I mean, they might be a little bit old now, but they'll give you an idea of the strategies and tactics and thinking behind what I was doing to get started. And what I would say is that although it worked for me, it was never going to become a six-figure business. So I've taken what I've learned, and I've moved to only advertise in tier one now. I don't do the global campaigns anymore. That's not to say that they don't work or can't work, but you'll never. It's going to be, I think, with those low cost campaigns to actually become super profitable, if you like. So it's a step. It's a sort of a scientific step. You can figure stuff out in this low cost playground. Have you got anything to add to that, Mitch?
Just that I went onto YouTube to see if they were floating about beer somewhere. And all I can see is Professor John Thwaites filling the dream, but it doesn't look like you. And another guy, message from the chairman, Professor John Thwaites. It also doesn't look like you. So it's not on YouTube.
No, that's not me. It'll be in the Launch You archive if it's anywhere, somewhere.
Sorry, John. I just wanted to question. I didn't hear properly. Did you say you're no longer doing the global campaigns? You're just doing local. Is that what you said?
Yeah. That's right. I think I mean, it doesn't matter who you talk to. You're only ever going to get opinions, aren't you? If you ask 100 people, you'll get 100 opinions, right? It's just it was my way of running adverts at very low cost and figuring a lot of stuff out without burning too much money. And the reason I say that is because you'll find you can get leads coming in from global campaigns for less than 20 cents, right? But as soon as you, let's say you target North America or Western Europe, you know, you're going to be paying at least 10 times that amount for one name and email address. You'll be minimum 150, €2 for a lead in the UK or, you know, anywhere else in sort of tier one, I would think. I think my leads in the UK are between 150 and €2 per name and email address. Whereas, you know, globally, they in some campaigns, they were actually under 20 cents.
But John does better ads than me because mine are between 350 and €5 per lead.
Yeah, I don't know whether that means it's a better ad or not. There might be something about the quality of the people that we're targeting, you know, as well. You know, some people are more expensive to get in front of. So if you target people with the keyword online, if you target the audience that Google provides online business, people that are interested in starting an online business, again, I'll pay nearer €4 for a lead in that audience. So there's more competition. This is the point. You know, the cost per lead has got something to do with the number of people that are advertising to those people. And the more competition there is, the more to bring in a name and email address. Okay.
See, the curious thing is Google does an automatic bid every time someone types in a search. So if someone types in online business, Google looks at everybody who's trying to bid for online business. It will take the most expensive one and play that person's ad. So the person with the highest bid. And it'll carry on doing that until that person's allocation of money for the day is finished. And then it will move down the next one. Because that's how Google works. They want to try and maximize how much money they get paid for their ads. So their algorithm just shoots around, picks up everybody who's looking for online business, chooses the one that they can get the most money for, and plays the ad. And then later in the day, they maybe used up those people's budget and the price comes down. But the difficulty with the World Wide Web is that now somebody else has popped up somewhere with more budget. So John's largely right. The more obvious the keyword, the more people are going to be waiting there for customers.
And I mean, if you're new here or newish, and maybe you haven't even started advertising yet, don't be too focused on the cost of that online business lead, because that's a warm audience, or maybe even a hot audience, right? And that's a different message. And so I'm targeting cold, right? And so although I'm playing around in that audience, that's not where my people are coming from. I'm targeting people that are problem aware, or maybe not even problem aware, and I'm bringing the problem to the top of mind. So these people, they're cooler than people that already know. They're cooler than people that are solution aware. Okay, they're different messages, different audiences, different tactics, and different pricing as well. For the leads that you bring in.
That's why what John said about doing the homework on your avatar correctly is so important. So I've just 2 weeks ago I started again at the beginning of Stuart's course. Because Caroline Grubb is going to bring out a video challenge, a 90-day video challenge in the next few weeks. And the start of that is always about finding your audience. And if you do the homework that Stuart describes in chapters 2 and 3 very thoroughly and in a lot of depth, you'll find out why your audience is different. Because something like Learn Online Marketing, it's so vanilla. And yes, everybody in the world is searching for it. But if you go right down deep into your avatar, you'll find something that appeals to them. And not only will you find that those leads are cheaper, you'll also find people who resonate with you and your message, be it on video or Google or Facebook or whatever. And that really is the trick to try and find people that are going to click, which isn't so hard to do. But then when they see you or read your message or come to your landing page, they're still happy to carry on working with you. And that's how you get the leads.
Mitch, I came to launch you through you on YouTube. Do you do advertising just on YouTube, or do you also go on Google?
I'm starting on Google, and I've done work on Facebook as well. But I'm starting a course about halfway through now, writing reviews of different products. And then the people hopefully are going to read the reviews. And at some point in the review, I recommend Launchpad as a solution. And then they click and they go to the landing page and then off they go again. But the thing I'm trying to do with writing reviews, if you can write a good review in a very curious topic, it'll go to the top of Google search, and it doesn't cost you any money when people click, because it's just real content. And that's what I'm trying to get to.
Isn't that what they do in Ignite?
Yes, Ignite did that training in January, February, I think.
Do you use AI, Mitch, to write your blogs?
No, I write the blogs myself, and then I send them to a guy in London who makes them interesting. The problem I've got with writing is I'm very left-brained. And so my writing, I think my writing reads like an IKEA cake recipe. You know what I mean? It's just blah, 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 blah. And so I've got this friend in London, mm-hmm. and he charges me so much per hour. So I send him my writing, tell him what I'm trying to do, and then he writes it again. He's a copywriter. That's his job. And then he writes it again, and it comes back. And I can see the difference. It comes back, and it's exciting. You know, you want to read what's written there rather than the instructions for mounting a table, not mounting a table, building a table. And he's very, very good at that. So I invest a bit of money up front to get a better article. And then that's how I do that.
Yes. Go on.
Because I tried with AI and it's fabulous how it works. You know, there's a couple steps because you need to introduce the pictures and everything. I haven't published anything. I'm just still training and trying to set up something, but it works very, very well. I learned this on YouTube on the site.
Yeah, there's lots of YouTube videos that you can go and watch that don't cost anything about writing articles. Lots and lots of them.
Yeah, it's funny. About 30 minutes before this call, I just wanted to get a broadcast scheduled for tomorrow because I've got to go out after this call and I'm not going to have any more time today. And I was, you know, time was short and I thought, oh, well, OpenAI, you know, ChatGPT, right? And I just put in a one sentence, bosh, up came the article. You know, I tell the AI that this is an email article that's going out to my subscribers, you know, and it's on this subject. And it is amazing how, you know, how swiftly and how well it does its job. And I just go into it every time. I never just copy and paste. I copy, paste, and then I edit. I copy and paste it into Aweb and then edit and then find the images and then, you know, make it look nice, get the font right and the space, you know, the paragraphs. All that, the justified. And we're possibly not using it enough, you know, this AI, but I think we're slowly, you know, Mitch and I, we've been using AI for video to make shorter videos out of longer videos, to embed in emails. And, you know, slowly we're sort of coming around to the idea that I've made life easy. And
Johan, you say we're, you talk about writing reviews. Is it worth linking a blog page to your ambassador website? So the answer is yes, but you have to fix up your ambassador website.
Because I
put a couple of articles there. Then the problem is that people would look at the article and, you know, maybe I am resonating with them. And when they came to my ambassador website, it was hopelessly similar to the one that Stuart sent me 2 years ago. So this picture of the people sitting on the beach, build your dream business. And it just, I asked my wife to go through these things because she's quite brutal. And if something's not right, she just tells me. Whereas if you ask friends, they try and be polite, which isn't always helpful. And she said she read the article, it was great. And then when she gets to my website, it's just from someone else. So I've had to pause for a moment, and now I'm rebuilding my ambassador website because I haven't really touched it in the beginning, because when I was advertising on YouTube, your website doesn't perform much of a function. It's sort of a holding position for your videos, for your emails and so on, but no one's really being sent to my website. But now I have to go and build my website properly. And that's the reason I've gone back to the beginning of Stuart's training, to build your avatar, because I think my avatar has changed from the one I drew up 2 years ago when I started. I'm trying to get different people. I got different things to say. So I'm writing that. Then I'll work with a guy, this guy, Andy in Zimbabwe, and I'll find new photos and I'll redo that whole front page of the website that they provided. Keep all the mechanics the same. And it'll have my photos and my body copy, my story.
Yeah, that was something that I've sort of found that quite a challenge early on, this whole avatar. It it always felt like I was just making stuff up. And I'm not telling you you've got to do this, but this is how I wound up having coaching. And I got into one of the coaching programs with the company, and they helped me in that regard as well. Get a lot more clarity on who I'm speaking with and the kind of language that I need to be using. So it's something to bear in mind, you know, that there is professional help there, obviously at a cost, but there is help there in that department if you feel you would benefit, or that would be a shortcut to getting a clear message out there to the right people.
But the problem with when you start is, you know, when I first got the website, downloaded it from Launchpad and I read it, and I thought, okay, I must now change this to my avatar. I couldn't change something because I didn't know enough. You know what I mean? You look at it and you think, that's actually quite good. Stuart's done quite a good job here. So I just took off all the capital letters because they seem to have got one of their fingers stuck in America, and every single word on a headline's got a capital, which drives me insane. So I went and took all the capital letters out of the sentences and made them into proper English. But then I thought, oh, that's fine. And it was only coming back to it 2 years later, and I was chatting to this guy in London to say, I need to do this again. And he said, whatever you do, don't start by reading that website, because you will just write it exactly the same again. Start by thinking what you want to say and put those headlines down, and then write what the words should be. Then I send it to him and he makes it interesting. But it's very different, because I remember, I can't remember, when I try and remember, what's the headline that's on the site they give us? Something like Build Digital Freedom, or I can't remember what it is.
Build a business and life that you love, maybe. I think that's the old one. I think that was the old website.
That's very different to how I would ever speak to anybody or say anything. I'm just clicking on my website here. Build Your Dream Online Business. There you go. So that's the website I've been having running forever. It says Build Your Dream Online Website. And behind it, there's 220-somethings sitting on the beach on their laptops. And it's just had nothing to do with me. I don't think I've ever said to anybody in a real conversation, digital freedom, laptop lifestyle. It's just not words that I use. And so I'm busy now doing the exercise of redoing that whole thing, so that when I send people from an article to my website, the whole website is congruent with my message. It looks like I've upset John there.
No, hardly.
No, the other John. Yeah, Johan. Oh. Johan's gone like this.
It does take a bit of doing, you know, and getting that clarity. And once you've got subscribers coming in, another way that you can help yourself is by using different ideas in the subject lines of emails as well. You know, and for instance, I can talk about retirement income, or I can talk about geographical freedom, or I can talk about meaningful work, or I can talk about contribution in a headline, better open rates than others. So I can start to figure out, you know, what is it that is resonating with my people? What do I need to, you know, sort of zero in on and maybe go into more deeply? Because these are going to be, you know, where you've got bigger open rates, where you've got higher open rates, you know, these are going to be the subjects where that they talk about meeting people where they're at, don't they? You know, we've all got a kind of conversation going on in our own mind, as weird as that might sound. You know, we're all talking to ourselves virtually all the time, right? And if I'm having thoughts, so I'll give an example, right? So before I discovered internet marketing, I was having this thought coming up in my mind every now and again that I'm Well, there were a number of thoughts, but one of them was there isn't going to be enough money to stop working at retirement. I haven't got pensions in place, you know, and I would just suppress that thought, right? I would just push it to the back of my mind, ignore it, start doing best to think about something else, do anything but address, acknowledge, and, you know, act on that thought, right? Now, I can't be the only person in the world that's approaching and isn't financially prepared. Okay, so we can, you know, through our communication, we can start to figure out whatever it is, you know, that is not just resonating, but that people are taking action. People are clicking on, and they either want to have a conversation with me, or they sign up for something. You know, they buy Modern Wealth or Launchpad to actually resolve the problem. Just thoughts for you, folks.
See, I don't want it. This worry that we've made it sound, judging by Johan's reaction, that we made it sound like there's so much to do. Remember the first time when I started. You're new and you don't know all these bits and bobs. So you download the website from Stuart and you do your first video and you put up the AWeber emails that this is, I'm presuming now we're talking about being an ambassador for Modern Wealthy. And you put all that stuff up and it starts to work. And then you sort of qualify from stage one. You think, okay, how can I do this better? And the first thing I did was look at my follow-up emails. And I chucked out Dan, because I think he's about 12. He looks like in there driving his sports car. I thought, well, that's not going to resonate with my audience. Out he went. There's a lady, Lundria, somebody. Out she went. And I left in the people that sort of resonated with me and my target audience. And I wrote some new emails. So I thought, okay, that's good. Then you go on to the next stage. So I thought, okay, now I have to do them even more personal. So I wrote about 18 different emails, as John is suggesting, sent them out. Now I'm going on to the next stage. And what I'm doing now and through the winter is I'm making a video. I'm doing a video for every single email that I send out. Because it just makes sense to me. You know, people came into the program because they watched a 4-minute video and they thought, oh, I'll give this a try. And then I never video them again. So I thought, oh, that's stupid. So now I'm going to make a series of 5-minute videos based on my best performing emails. And now if they open up, they can watch a video, they can read the content. So I think it's just step by step. You get everything going and you start again and you see what you can improve. And you start again and you see what you can improve. And in the process, my target audience has changed, because at first I would do anything to get someone to sign up to Modern Wealthy. And then it changed after about 6 months. I thought, okay, actually, I want people to come to Launchpad. And now it's changing again. I thought, well, if you really want to make this thing work on its own when you retire in 2 years, you want people who are going to sign up for gold. So I'm going back now and starting to chat to people and interview people who've come on and joined gold. And now I'm going to go back and start again. So change my video. Change all the emails, just because that's who I'm talking to. So after 2 years, I'm finally listening to Stuart's second training, which is go down, go down, go down to get to your real avatar. And if you do that properly, those are the most powerful lessons. I think it's lesson 2 and 3 in his schedule. And I'm busy doing them again now, 2 years and 2 months in. And I don't think there's a shortcut. I think you have to go through all those stages, like learning at school. You know, you can't come into class and the teacher says, right, let's do trigonometry. Because if you're in grade one, you're going to think, what? Let's do 2 plus 2. You know what I mean? I'll tackle that for a while. And that's just how it works. You just move up. The other thing that I've got is whenever I learn something like this on Modern Wealthy, then I stop and I go for a month and I change everything on the guest house site and I change everything on the training site. So all of the sites keep improving. And slowly, slowly you can see the effect. You know, I have a bad month and a good month, but August was very good on all three sites. And they've just changed and improved so much in the last 2 years. And as I say, I think I'll do another 2 or 3 years, and then my plan is to have 5 sites that are running, earning about $2,000 a month each, and that'll be fine. I'll retire then, and I'll go and stay in John's new house, not do any work. Should be finished in 3 years' time.
Yeah. 3 years is probably about right, Mitch, I reckon.
My hand is up.
Oh, geez, where does the hand up go? Put your hand up, really.
There we are.
Okay, then.
Okay. Thank you for that inspired little talk there, Mitch. It was a real good one. I just want to go back to the review article. Where do you write a review article? On which platform, guys? Is it on Google Search Ads, or where do you write these review articles, and why are they called review articles?
So you've caught somebody here who's 3/4 of the way through the training, okay? And it's training that I'm doing.
John can just answer. Yeah.
I don't know. John, do you write review articles?
No, I haven't. But I think the idea, I think that Stefan May did the training, right? And the way I believe it works is you post the articles on your own website. You can post them on your own WordPress site, okay? Stuart, in the previous training, he always talks about the money post, right? So you have a page on your website which talks about affiliate marketing, or talks about retiring, which talks about solving retirement income problems, or talks about whatever you are a stand for, okay? Whatever your spin on the idea of reskilling is, okay? So you post it on your website. It's embedded with hyperlinks to what are they going to be embedded to? They're going to be embedded to, let's say, the Modern Wealthy video sales letter, right? The Modern Wealthy sign-up page, or the Launchpad sign-up page, one or the other, okay? And then what you do is you run Google pay-per-click ads so that you appear on page one of Google, right? You run an ad, you know, how to become an affiliate marketer in the next 30 to 60 days, let's say. That's the pay-per-click ad headline, right? And so you don't pay, now you're on page one of Google, not paying anything at all for that ad unless someone clicks. And if they click, they go to the article, right? That, I believe, is the way that it works. And then as they read the article, they're going to be CTAs in there.
Calls to action,
hyperlinks, you know, click here, start your, reskill now, whatever. Okay, I believe that's the way that particular strategy works. And it's, if you blog, and you want Google to pick you up, so this is called search engine optimization, and start placing you near a page one all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have to be posting consistently for a number of months, right? That's the organic route, but paid is a shortcut, and you now know that you can use it. You can have a daily budget of $1 a day. That won't get you much traffic, but it will get you started.
Thanks very much indeed for your patient explanation, John. Much obliged. Thank you.
I'm going to show you a slightly different variation. Share screen. Okay. So here's a search. I just typed in Labrador training book. And so you can see now that's such a broad, I mean, look at how many books there are. It's such a broad statement, and I'm going to be competing with Amazon, the Labrador site, Labrador training, but then in comes Waterstones, and these people are all running ads around training Labradors. So I've tried to make it a bit broader. How do you sand a teak desk? That still seems, there's people out there, teak master. And all of these ones are people who are running sites. There comes WikiHow, that's a bit broad. I went again, hotels in France, and that's what I was after. This is a sponsored ad. So these people have paid to run the ad. So it's booking.com. And there's Trivago, luxury hotel guides. So usually you'll find these people taking all the top spots because they're doing that. Now, the thing about these Harvey Sander teak desk, I don't know, I was trying to make it more obscure. So these are people who've put up videos, but if I go down to the website, you can see these people are popping up. Now, I don't know any of these sites because you just saw me type it up. My understanding is they won't pay for this because it's not a pay-per-click.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
They're only going to pay. You're only going to pay if you ask them to pay something. So in I go, he's telling me all about this and how to do that, legal information. I can watch all his stuff. At some point on his site, so he's running ads here as well. Can you see? So he's getting a bit of money from that. He's getting a bit of money from running that ad. He's got frequently asked questions. And then here's all his sponsored content. People are running stuff. So this guy's making money because his site seems to be good. And so people come to it and read about how to sand teak desks in yellow, but there's links. People who sell sandpaper, people who sell varnish, he's got links to all of them and he's making money that way. So you can, the thing I'm trying to do is twofold. So I want to write a fantastic article, the three different topics that I've chosen. One of them I'm going to do as John suggests. So if somebody clicks, I pay for the click, takes them to my Modern Wealthy page. There they can read the whole article and it tells them about Modern Wealthy. They click, it takes their name and address, and they're off. The other one I want to try and do is just take the article, put it on Google, and hopefully because it's a good article, the search terms match. It comes up a lot. A lot of people click on it, and it moves up the Google pages. And that's my ambition, to see if I can get two or three articles high up on Google pages without paying any money. And for me, that would be quite a smart way to do advertising. So if the Google article is a good article and it's popular, Google will move it up. As John's saying, over a couple of months, Google will say, well, everybody who opens this article, goes in, reads the article, clicks on a couple of the links, it must be a useful article. And there's all the little tricks there. If the thing is how to earn money online, and then I've got all the right keywords in the article. All these things make Google search move the article up. And so that's my task in the next 3 to 6 months, to see if I can get three of these articles high on Google search without paying any money. And again, the trick is to find an obscure market, an obscure keyword. Because if you go into Google, I'll just show you again now. Often these experiments don't work when I do them live, but that's just what happens. So if I type in here, earn online. $2,510,000 results in less than a third of a second. So you haven't got a chance. There's Instagram, Pinterest, Google, YouTube, you're going to die there. But if you just took something like retired, what did you call yourself, John Carpenter?
I call myself a woodworker.
Okay.
But carpenter's good enough. Carpenter's a woodworker that works on site. A joiner makes windows and doors in a workshop, and a cabinet maker makes furniture.
Somewhere in my phone's ringing. It's in my pocket, sorry. This window. So let's just see here now, a retired woodworker in Spain. So you can see it's better now. People have got these are all private sites. And this is where I'm going to try and get that's a sponsored site. Say it's sponsored. BBC. But now you're getting into people's private sites. Baylor University, Dreamline. And these guys are trying to get these articles up. You've got to, it's hard because again, for some reason, all these ones seem to be media. University, eBay, Northeast Retirement Life. This is yours, John. And so there's an article that someone's done, but he's written the article. You can see he's selling ad space on the article. The more you can join his newsletters, there's more articles. So that's how that person is making some money from writing articles. So that's the route I'm trying to go. I'm going to write articles, put them out there, and go for obscure markets where I can get the article near the top of the page or somewhere on the top of the page. Someone clicks, it goes to my Modern Wealthy website, and then they're into the normal system. So that's a whole lot of chat about something I don't know much about. Because I'm new.
So you write the article on your website, or you write the article on your website?
I think so. I'm busy writing the articles now. And then I've seen Martin do a training. You open up your normal website and you can create three little blocks. And then you put three pictures with the headline and the first paragraph and they sit there. But no one's going to see that. You have to go and buy ads.
Yeah, I don't know whether you pay for a Gmail account. No, so that do you pay Google anything for the workspace, for Google Workspace?
You mean me?
Well, I was asking Carol actually. Yeah. But
I thought so.
I think I'll pay something like €4 per month for a Gmail. For a Gmail business email. So what that means is my website's future-proof for life. So I can have john@futureprooffor.life.com as an email, number one. But number two, it gives me access to Google Workspace. So I don't need to have virtually any software at all on my computer because I've got Google Documents, I've got a Google Drive. Right.
Yeah, I've got that.
Well, in among that, if you scroll down, if you click on the Google Switch chart and you scroll down, you've got something called Blogger.
Oh, really?
Have a look at that. That's free. You can probably something. You can probably have something like blog.carolsutcliffe.com, free. Well, included with your whatever it is you pay a month. You know,
but I'm also going to have a blog on my website.
Yeah. You can just duplicate it, can't you? You know, the more pages you've got out there.
Oh, awesome. Wow. Thank you, John. Yeah. This is a really useful call, guys. Thank you.
John, Johan, you just asked me a question about my pay grade. There's 14 lessons in Martin's training, and I'm on number 8 or 9. So... I believe that I put the articles in my website. So there's the three articles will sit in my website, and then I post links to them. I can either do pay-per-click ads, which just have a couple of words headline. If somebody clicks on that, they're taken to the article, and then I try and run the articles in the Google organic as well.
Yeah, what I would say to people is the reason why they're going with the pay-per-click ads is because it's just instant, right? You'll drive people to your webpage today if you set the campaign up today. Whereas if this is blogging, right? This is blogging. Blogging isn't somebody going on a road trip and posting up photographs of themselves. Blogging is a science, and it's a hugely lucrative branch of internet marketing, right? And I think we've spoken about this before. If you look at any financial products, or if you put any financial search into Google, so if you put in something like anything to do with retirement, pensions, investments, mortgages, loans, anything like this, you'll find all the usual suspects come up on page one of Google, right? It'd be Fidelity, be Forbes, it'll be all these mega companies that have got blogs in place, right? And they know what they're doing, right? They're littered with keywords. They've got things in there called backlinks. These posts are hooked up to all sorts of other sites. And Google recognizes these pages as highly credible, all right? And, you know, they've been there for years posting this kind of information, and they've migrated up to page one, right? Now, for you to get in on that kind of action is a big ask. You're going to have to find an obscure niche, right? This isn't to say there's no money in it. There's still plenty of money in it, but you're going to have to find a niche where you can shine and where you can wind up on page one. But to shortcut all of that, just publish your article on your WordPress website or anywhere on the free blogger with Google Workspace, right? And drive people to it using a paid advert. It's instantaneous. This is the beauty of paid marketing, right? It's instant. You get instant feedback. You know what works, what doesn't. You're very focused on it because you're spending your own money. That word spending will turn into investing and then doubling, hopefully trebling or quadrupling your own money, right? You know, when you get everything right. But this is the reason why it's probably most sensible at the outset to start with a low daily budget and use ads. Stefan may suggest pay-per-click ads. That's what he does. This is how he earns money doing this, using this strategy. So yeah, be a bit more focused on the paid route than the SEO route at the moment is what I would.
Yeah, John is right, because if I just did organic, which is the big word for unpaid, it takes 6 or 8 months before you know whether you've written a good article. But if you paid per click, you pay, and the clicks are cheap. So you pay every time somebody clicks, and you'll see, do they like the article, or do they just read half and then leave? Within 3 or 4 days, you'll know if it's a good article. Of waiting 6 months and then finding out that it's not a good article.
Okay.
So getting questions come up from user. Where do you find an accountability partner? Hello, Zakiri Osman. The best place to find accountability partners. I'm going to share my screen again. Sorry, John. Let me just try and get it right.
What I would suggest, user, I don't know what your name is, but what I would suggest you do also, in addition to listening to Mitch right now, is have a look at the recording of this, because we both go into a lot of detail at the very beginning of this call about how you find an accountability partner. We both contribute to that question, and you've got pretty much everything you need. So I'm going to be sending the recording out in the next, probably tomorrow, but no longer than 48 hours. And I think Mitch will be doing the same. So,
yeah. Here's what your page looks like. So you know this place here, Mentors. You go there and you can just type, "Hi, I'm Mitch. I'm on this lesson. I'm looking for an accountability partner." And then just leave it there for a couple of days. Now, remember that it's not a sign that nobody wants to be your partner if you don't get an answer straight away, because on this call, I think we've got about 20 people at the moment. I don't know who last went to the messenger page on Mentors and read the messages, but you can read 4 or 5 or 6. And then most of them seem to be beginners saying, "Hi, Zach, Alcoholics Anonymous. Hi, I'm Mitch, and I joined here because I want to get financial freedom and build a business going forward." Because that's what Stuart says you have to do in the first module. So you read 3 or 4 of those, and then you jump off because it's a bit boring. But if you go through, you'll see people are asking questions. There's people asking advice. And just every few days, just pop up there and type in, "I'm looking for an accountability partner. I'm on module 5, somebody to help me drive through," and somebody will pop up.
Okay. I don't know whether we, I probably make an assumption that we run this call for 1 hour, and I always look at the clock, and if we've gone past the top of the hour, I think we're overrunning.
We run it until it gets boring, eh?
Yes, but I think we probably run it until we run out of questions.
Yeah.
So But as we've been here for an hour and 10 already, I'm going to encourage you to ask your questions now. Otherwise, we're going to start to think about winding things up. So is there anybody else that wants to come out and talk to us?
I want to say thank you very, very much, guys. You're the best. God bless you.
Thank you.
I think her signal cut up there because she was going to say, and you're very good looking, but it broke off at that point. So I just thought I'd add that on.
You've got a sense of humor, Mitch.
You've got to have it. I learned it in South Africa.
You did.
We're very funny in South Africa.
Yeah,
we know how to laugh at ourselves, Mitch.
Well, if you don't, we're going to.
Yeah. Ask Carol, where do you stay in South Africa?
I'm staying in a little seaside town called Fishhook.
Where are you, Virginia?
You're just down the road from me.
There's two accountability Seriously? Partners. Yeah.
What?
Virginia and Carol, chat to each other.
I'm in Plumstead. Just up the road, not far from you.
Prospect.
Plumstead, yeah, half an hour away from you.
Okay, I'll meet you on Mentors.
Okay.
Why don't you just select a coffee shop for tomorrow morning at 10?
Yes, that's such a good idea because it's Heritage Day tomorrow, so it's a public holiday in South Africa. Our favorite restaurant is by the beach.
Oh, the galley.
Galley. Yeah.
But Kat, you'll recognize Carol because she'll go there wearing her Batman outfit. So just look for the person in the Batman outfit and that'll be Carol.
I live in my tracksuit.
Okay, but Carol, I know we're going to have rain, but if you want to meet at 11, I'll meet you there.
At 11. No, we'll chat on Mentors. We won't take up these good people's time now.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot.
John and Mitch starting a dating site. Anyway.
Guys, thank you so much.
Thanks, guys.
Cheers. Okay. All right. Well, yeah, thank you all very much for coming along and making it, as interactive, stimulating and fun as it's been. I appreciate you guys.
We're off. I'll send a recording. Cheers all.
Over and out.